Methodist Christianity in Kingswinford by David Atkinson at the request of Rex Deakin, principally about the Sunday School, to mark the 50th anniversary of the church in Stream Road, June 2016. Chapter 1, Setting the Scene. My first contact with the Methodist Church in Kingswinford was Sunday School at the old Mount Pleasant Chapel. My parents moved to 60 Cot Lane when the house was completed in 1951, and I soon found many local children to befriend. As in any community, there were some I shared happy times with, and some I was more reticent about and avoided or kept a close eye on. Graham Road, down the side of our house, was at that time unadopted, in other words, rough, bumpy and stony, which proved to be a useful play area for youngsters living in the road, as there was virtually no through traffic. Moving down the road away from our house, there was Lyndon Bird, Lorraine Barry and Stephen Randall, Robin Evans, the Hillman and Ives children, and the two Barchin boys, John Wilkinson and Alan Moore. On the other side we had Carol West, Janet Perks, Marilyn and Angela Smallman, Mary Whitworth, Rosalind Lowe, Diane King, Roger, Richard and Mary Shuttleworth, and Tony Rutter, well known for racing motorcycles, including the Max TT. With the exception of the latter, who was older, we all associated with each other either as close pals or acquaintances. We had an abundance of places to go to play, including the field between Graham Road South Side and the allotments, the operational sand quarry under and around the Monkey Bridge, the old sand quarry to the north of Graham Road, which was used as an industrial waste tip for metal, rods, bars, plastic, paint, timber, soil, unwanted aggregate, defunct electrical gadgets, and so on. This was a boy paradise, as you can imagine, which now is 20 feet under Barney Close, as the bigger sand quarry is under Dean Avenue. Prior to Graham Road being given proper road, path and grass surfaces, the area outside our corner garden wall became a maze of bike tracks, which brought hours of fun and fitness. It was a sad day when we realised that sandstone and soil excavated from the site of new buildings at Fry's Die Castings at the bottom of Brewery Street, Wordsley, itself covered with housing now, and transported in two American six-wheel trucks, was to completely fill the tip. We took our play very seriously and made good use of the space available in parents' gardens. We organised the building of a pretend radio station, complete with programme schedules. It utilised some of the waste electrical stuff from the tip behind 10 Graham Road, so we became Cot Lane Power and Radio Station, even down to having the initials CLPARS painted on a hand cart, with which my father won our disapproval by referring to it as Clappers. We moved activities to Roger and Richard's garden, where the availability of materials from the tip led to all sorts of construction ideas. As there was ample slow-burning material such as tarpaulin, we built a furnace which consumed the stuff voraciously. This was a real bruiser of a device. It was made of brick in the form of a tunnel with the stoker's place roofed in slotted angle metal sheeting, and at the other end a 5-foot by 10-inch sewer pipe for a chimney. Its time ended when Eva, the lad's mom, poured water down the chimney, fearing it was out of control. The lad's dad, Gilbert, joined in helping with the Hornby Clockwork O-gauge train and a gadget that flashed a light in the shed when a bike ran over a board outside. This was way before transistors and infrared detectors, and to this day I still have no idea how he did it. So it was against this background that I was introduced to Mount Pleasant Primitive Methodist Sunday School. Primitive related to the organisation and type of worship, which was less sophisticated than the Wesleyan Methodists found at Moss Grove. David Rice wrote a book describing Methodism in Kingswinford. It would make an interesting read if you can find a copy, though it is now on Google or YouTube. Mount Pleasant Chapel was on the north side corner of the said street, that is Mount Pleasant, facing the recreation ground, Homer's Field. While the Sunday School Hall was at the back facing Mount Pleasant Road, nothing remains of this now, but we still have the two beautiful stained glass windows in Stream Road Church foyer, which were high on the west wall of the old chapel, on either side of the pulpit, and on spring evenings would be beautifully illuminated by the setting sun. The Sunday school had a stage with a big easel holding the pack of huge sheets of paper on which were printed the hymns we regularly sang. The opening few minutes, however, were given over to Cliff College choruses, which we had to learn, not forgetting the actions, of course. Away Far Beyond Jordan, I Will Make You Fishers of Men, Only a Boy Called David, Now Zacchaeus Was a Very Little Man, I'm H-A-P-P-Y, Climb, Climb Up Sunshine Mountain, were just a few and you never forget them. Staff included Ken Hill, Lizzie Churchill, John, Cecil and Ruth Ryder, Len Roberts with June and Edith, the sisters Joyce Beard, Dorothy Pearson and Margaret Randall, Bill Marsh JP and Lizzie Tickley, and there must be some I've forgotten. At this point I must confess to not always being the perfect pupil. Unlike day school, there were no major disciplinary measures the staff could take against any miscreants apart from informing parents, but they could be asked to leave. This did happen to me, fortunately, in good weather, as I dare not go home before the normal time, so us ejected ones would go on Homer's Field playground rides until the good uns came out. Eventually, as I became more mature, like a good cheese, I was roped in to help with administration, playing the piano, writing letters of invitation to preachers for Sunday school anniversaries, one of which was one of my grammar school teachers, helping Lizzie Churchill choose prizes for the pupils, and so on. The surroundings were far from palatial. A bareboard wooden floor, hard flat wooden benches to sit on, and when the afternoon sessions broke up into smaller groups, I forgot to mention there was an afternoon session too, the side rooms used were definitely in need of serious renovation. The sanctuary had simple, arch-topped metal-framed windows at ground floor level and at what would be at first floor level in a house, with a side recess housing the wind-blown organ ably played by Mrs. Piercy. At the front was the altar table behind the altar rail, then the high and wide pulpit positioned between and below the two stained glass windows mentioned above. Morning pupils were always being persuaded to go into morning service for a while, as it was the custom for the preacher to have a message for the young people. Very few, if any, took up the invitation. However, on anniversary day, there were three services, including singing and recitations from the children, morning, afternoon and evening. The chapel would be packed and my shirt would stick to the varnish on the pew back as the sun streamed in through the lovely windows, and the children sat arrayed before us on specially constructed platforms, all in their Sunday best clothes. All this followed the morning street parade led by a marching band of bugles and drums, with the pupils and staff following and a police constable in front and behind. This happens rarely now because of health and safety reasons, following some nasty accidents involving overtaking vehicles, but not here, I might add. To earn some pocket money, Phil Granger and I used to go out painting and decorating with Len Roberts during the long summer holidays. We learned many aspects of this profession, which came in very useful when we had homes of our own. Len was easy to identify in a crowd due to his pronounced stutter, but this didn't impede him communicating with us, and we enjoyed long chats about church life and the things in general, and the dark secrets of the Sunday school staff. I'm only joking. As with nearly all who stutter, Len had a lovely singing voice, which he used to great effect in the church choir, and no stuttering. We didn't quite get to singing instructions to each other, but that would have been a good idea. Chapter 2, The Last Days. Being away at college in Cheltenham for 3 years, I missed the dramatic few days which helped shape the old chapel's destiny. We had a very cold snap in the winter of 1961-2. The result was the old chapel's boilers burst, not the fault of the caretaker, rendering the property useless for worship. As a result of the boiler disaster, the congregations graciously accepted the invitation to worship at Moss Grove, itself not an ideal site and which was also in need of some expensive renovation. The minister at that time was the Reverend Alan Kinsey, who, along with the trustees and other officers of both churches, was charged with the task of solving the problem. The answer was concealed in the way the two congregations blended. Establish one new place of worship that all can feel a part of, but the question remained where, and a second question, how. Alan used the best of his persuasive powers to start to accumulate the money needed for this project, and the by no means easy task of finding a site. Between Broadfield Close and Broadfield House was a private cricket field owned by a local developer, Kenneth McMaster, who was prepared to sell an area of land fronting the Main Street Road and accessed from the drive to Broadfield House and New Bradley Hall for the elderly. This was about halfway between the two old buildings. As for funds, the post office wanted a delivery base in the village, so they were prepared to purchase the Mossgrove site and a housing development company, the Mount Pleasant site. The Rank organisation provided some funding. Local people were approached, including the Smith family, who donated the original stained glass windows in Mount Pleasant Chapel and lived in a very secluded old house tucked away under trees at the end of Mount Pleasant when it finished at the field now covered by Lawnswood Avenue. This field carried a footpath continuing on from that crossing the sand quarry by the Monkey Bridge. There were the usual fundraising events, and everyone collected cash in their homes with such things as sunshine bags, swearing boxes, I hope not, buy a brick and the organ fund in which I participated. One encouraging detail was that a paying request enabled the land to be purchased almost immediately. During my time at St Paul's College, progress was fast. Designed by Desmond Crewe, a modern complex of sanctuary, hall, side rooms, kitchen, toilets and minister's bungalow was taking shape. The former having a most distinctive roof and specially made coloured glass windows in the form of rectangular rough surfaced concrete slabs with chunks of thick coloured glass in this such that light can shine through. My last contact with Mossgrove was to organise and play for a presentation of Geoffrey Beaumont's 20th Century Folk Mass. This is a musical setting of the communion service where the congregation follows the lead of a cantor. That evening, Noel Lee played the organ, my college friend Bob Davis, now sadly deceased, played drums, the young people led the congregation in their responses, Len Key was the cantor, and I played the piano. As all this was going on, Fred Truin, one of the trustees and skilled in graphics, designed a new symbol to represent the two churches combining. It is so simple, two smaller crosses set against a larger one in shades of blue and black. It is still used to this day and easily recognised. Chapter 3, A New Beginning. I returned finally from college in time for the various ceremonies associated with closing churches. Would you call that unsanctifying them? And dedicating new ones. The service for Mount Pleasant Chapel's closure saw every pew filled as the combined congregations, plus circuit staff, district officers and invited guests crammed into the limited space available. This was held on Sunday the 11th of July 1965 at 6 p.m. and all sang the good old hymns heartily and a few tears were shed as the old building was decommissioned. Prior to demolition, the two stained glass windows were carefully removed to be installed in the link of the new church along with the window from Mossgrove. The date of Mossgrove Church's closure was Sunday the 12th of July 1966, as the premises would be needed until the opening of the new church. As the only habitable space was at Mossgrove, procedures had to take place at Mount Pleasant first. But finally, the great day arrived when the two groups would all become members of one new Kings Winford Methodist Church, or Stream Road Church as it became affectionately known to some people. Timeline for these events are Sunday the 23rd of June 1963, service to consecrate the site. Saturday the 19th of June 1965, laying of the foundation stone by Kenneth McMaster. Sunday the 11th of July 1965, service to close Mount Pleasant Chapel. Sunday the 18th of July 1965, service of union for the old church societies. Saturday the 18th of June 1966, opening and consecration. Chapter 4, Up and Running. Once in the new premises we could bask in the newness of it all, but there was still lots of money to raise. At that time there was no link between the M6 and M5 motorways, consequently holidaymakers from up north found themselves meandering through Wolverhampton and King's Winford en route for the M5 at Lydiate Ash, or Worcester North. An ambitious scheme was conceived to lay on an all-night coffee bar and cook breakfasts at sunup. There was no shortage of volunteers to staff this, and it proved popular with the local constabulary, who popped in to see that we were okay and have a cuppa. A big illuminated poster advertising this was placed outside the old Moscow Chapel, so patrons were well prepared to stop for refreshment. Many families made a point of calling on their way back. The first Sunday school at the new venue was under the care of Len Key, with Derek Civita as secretary and Stan Philpott, Stan Bedard and Lynn Jones sharing the load. My involvement in the Sunday school now was primarily as an accompanist for the singing. This was a very busy job at the time of Sunday school festival. With all the rehearsing, the term anniversary was dropped for a less dated term. There was such a demand that the church opened an afternoon school in Bromley Hills Primary School for families on High Acres. This was in Irene Hitch's charge and Alan Dealey was secretary. I played the piano for them too. As an aside, this event shows the enthusiasm at work in our congregation at this time. Soon after Bill and Dorothy Stubbs joined us, the circuit, Stourbridge and Barley Hill churches combined, was asked to organise some way of using the visit of an overseas missionary here on leave, so that as many people as possible could hear him speak. The poor man was initially quite overwhelmed by what greeted him as he entered the new hall at King's Winford. The whole room had been converted into a tropical paradise. There were cardboard and crepe paper palm trees suspended on wires from the roof, with gently whirring fans to move the leaves, orange cardboard sand giving way to artificial grass, overhead projector created water ripples on the wall behind the sand, and from discreetly placed loudspeakers, the soft sound of gentle surf from a tape loop on a recorder. Add to this the ladies of the church led by Dorothy Stubbs, serving tropical refreshments accompanied by Hawaiian music, attired in grass skirts, and you have an evening to remember, as I did. Now, some soul searching that may surprise, I had been raised a Methodist attending Brockmore Chapel with my parents and maternal grandparents, been through Sunday school, taken part in pageants at St James's Church Penzit at the behest of Dorothy Foisey, gone through all the activities above, including the folk mass I rehearsed people in and played for at college, been to a televised Billy Graham rally with Bill Stubbs, heard countless sermons, uttered thousands of Lord's prayers without being a committed Christian. I was going through the motions without experiencing the faith. I was in this state of spiritual limbo when Alan Kinsey's talents were recognised and he was moved to Conisborough in South Yorkshire. Phil Granger and I went to stay with the family over a weekend, during which Phil met Linda, his future wife, and I met Christine, lovely girl but not my future wife. In following visits we used to battle my little old lost in A35 car up the A38, M1, M18, whilst it was regularly overtaken by trucks. In February 1971, John Priest and I were invited to a rally at Five Ways Chapel, Gornal, where Eddie Jones, an evangelist from Crewe, made the penny drop as to who Jesus really is and what my relationship with him should be. I finally understood the commitment he wanted and I made it there and then on the 21st of that month, my second birthday if you like. You can't become a Christian vicariously or as a result of others' efforts. It must be your decision, your personal agreement with the creator of the universe. Mind-blowing, don't you think? My friendship with John came out of us both taking part in some Songs from the Shows concerts organised by young folks formerly from Bridal Hill Grammar School, with some additions like Paula Durant and myself. These were of a very high standard and proved very popular with the church members and families. Before 1971, I trod the boards singing with Bridal Hill Amateur Operatic Society, which introduced me to a new experience and new friends. When one of the ladies in the soprano section heard that Sheila and I were, as they say today, an item, she gave Sheila a netting present for capturing me.
Oh, we know, sir, we can't win you with the slow time minuet. There's a mother flair within you for a speedy meeting net.
With a new commitment, I became pianist to the senior department, working with Ray Hill and David Raybould, now sadly deceased. Most of the music then was from the Spring Harvest Annual Gatherings at Filey. This was before the outreach programme in 1972 called Towards 72, which involved making the community aware of Jesus' presence and love for us. Four Cliff College students came down, which enabled other activities to go on in the church and hall. Many people came to experience the Holy Spirit in action and committed themselves for the first time or renewed their Christian trust and faith. David Raybould was one of the latter, and he became a founder and first pastor of the Christian Centre in Park Street, Kings Winford. In its 50-year history, the church has influenced many who have gone on to spread the gospel in various ways. Charged with our spiritual feeding was our next minister, Bill Stubbs, with his wife Dorothy, who played a mean accordion, and children Paul and Julia. They were made very welcome, and though now in a residential home, Bill, who survived Dorothy, still attends morning worship at the time of writing. During its 50 years existence, the church has had the following ministers for its care. Times are approximate. Reverend Alan Kinsey, 1966. Reverend Bill Stubbs, 1966 to 1973. Reverend George Cloak, 1973 to 1976. Reverend John Bromley, 1976 to 1987. Reverend Jeff Rushton, 1987 to 1992. Reverend Tony Stones, 1992 to 1994. Reverend Judith Lloyd, 1995 to 6, though she was then Briner. Reverend Andrew Roberts, 1997 to 2002. Reverend Jan Tate, 2002 to 2007. Reverend Mike Williams, 2007 to 2014. Reverend Derek Lander, 2014. Sister Betty Vaughan covered the period 1994 to 95. With the absence of David Raybould, I gradually began to join in teaching with Ray Hill in the senior department. Christine Rolfe joined the teaching staff too, though she was later to join David at the Christian Centre. As secondary school teaching was my 9-to-5 job, I had promised myself that I would not do this on Sunday too. Ah well, promises, promises. At about this time, two young people's groups, one from New Street Wordsley and one from Stream Road Church, got together meeting on Sunday evenings for fellowship and fun. They produced review-style shows to raise money to give underprivileged children fun days out. I'm not sure about the ratings of these. For example, Prince Charming. Where's my chambermaid? Butler, Stoke-on-Trent. Audience member. Would any member of the panel succumb to wearing false teeth? Panelist. Ah, they should make them all strawberry flavoured, then everyone would suck them. Or, this is BBC BC. Here is the news. The senior astronomer in Jerusalem has had to step down. He could no longer use the telescopes because one eye is higher than the other. Or, did you hear? They are going to consecrate them new footpaths up the Krim. And they? I thought they was going to tarmac them. I was made very welcome by the two groups, now become one under the name New Streamers. I don't have to tell you how that came about. The group attended a rally at Five Ways Church, Gornal, where ex-Cliff College man and evangelist Tom Butler was speaking. He spoke powerfully about Jesus' sacrifice for us, how he conquered death, and how his Holy Spirit guides and enables us to do his will and comforts us. When he asked if anyone who felt a need for the presence of the Holy Spirit in their lives would come to the altar rail for prayers and a blessing, no compulsion. The young folks didn't wait to excuse me, etc., along the pews and up the aisle. They went over the pews to the front. Tom is no longer with us, but if you could meet him and ask him about that evening, he would readily recollect it, as it made such an impression. The newfound enthusiasm for the gospel meant a change of emphasis in the group, which developed into a gospel choir, complete with guitar backing, involving upwards of 40 members. Instead of attending rallies like Arthur Blessett's, they organised rallies and led instead of followed. And some wrote their own gospel songs rather than sing others' material. They linked up with other groups, in particular the Anglicans at Womburn. That brought us into contact with the Reverend Derek Hanscom, now sadly deceased. Then the Bishop of Lichfield's youth chaplain. And we took part in services he was responsible for. We even sang in Lichfield Cathedral. One weekend we were asked by Les Piercy, husband of the Mount Pleasant organist, to take his local preacher's appointment at Minsterley in the wilds of Shropshire. Of course, nothing we initiate or organise lasts forever. Frank Marler reminded us of that during the Bible study session that he and his wife Ruby used to host for us. We were concerned that it appeared the cohesion of the group was weakening, but in a way this was inevitable as members moved away, went to college or university, met partners, several couples in the group married and others' circumstances changed. It served its purpose at the time and that's what's important. The few who kept going joined the Birmingham area choir for presenting the musical Come Together, or still sang and played as the combo. The last appearance of this was at Sheila's and my wedding reception. The author has CDs of the songs and DVDs of some of the rallies we organised, and most are on YouTube. Time passed and after Christine Rolfe's departure I began to get involved in the teaching, though accompanying the singing was done as well. Extra work and so interest came with Christmas and festival preparations, and in those days during Jeff Rushton's reign we did have an anniversary procession. In 1988 we marched behind a bugle and drum band, took a portable PA public address system with us, Marion Norris played a battery pad keyboard for the singing and Jeff and I took it in turns to shout for Jesus, which I found quite thrilling. I never know what to say until I start saying it, then it just flows. I wonder who from.
Since the day when we was strangely warned, said that this was one of the most important things, if not the most important thing, in a person's life. That they should come to an understanding of exactly how much God loves them. This love for us was demonstrated in the love and the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. I'm not going to say to you this morning that there are many ways to many gods. There aren't. And if you believe that, then I'm very sorry. I apologize in advance. There is only one God, supreme over all the earth and creation. There is only one Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it's very difficult for us mere humans to understand the importance of Christ in the world today. We see that the world seems to drift on in its own way. And we don't see God and we don't see Jesus in the things that happen. Yet he's there because he's a God of love, not compulsion. God sends us power into our own lives through his Son, so that no matter what befalls us, if we believe in him and have accepted him into our lives, then in the end, all will be well.
Man this You're morning who's in charge of the coordination of this wonderful exercise. You can see the effect it's had on his brain by the state of his head.
I'm glad you haven't got that switched on then.
I'm hoping now that my eldest son has got the machine, doesn't press the wrong button and wipe out like the video recorder, but I'm going to say it this morning, all the way through our lives, from the cradle to the grave, we've got a record going on, just like the tape we're in the machine. On that tape, we've got episodes in our lives, good ones and bad ones. Some of us may think our life is full of wonderful things. Compare our lives with those of Christ, and we find they are. Some of us may have had episodes in our lives that we wish we could forget, but we can't forget. Well, I've got good news for you. At the time when you say yes to the Lord Jesus Christ and invite him into your life, God presses the erase button. And it's almost as if everything that passed before has been wiped away. And you receive a new birth, a new chance for a new life with him. And if that isn't good news, I don't know what is.
Meanwhile, Ray was coming to the position I was in a few years ago, which is preparing to let others take the strain. The one picking up the baton was Mark Clark, who moved here from up north, well, Crewe actually, with wife Enid and daughter Rachel. They soon felt at home and were eager to contribute to the life of the church, and Ray's job was just the ticket for Mark, who enthusiastically took on the senior department. We motored on routinely, making what we hoped were interesting and original contributions to the more prominent church services and festivals, and enjoying different surroundings on the Sunday School annual day out. I remember one to Ludlow, one to Much Wenlock, and one to Coventry, but of course there were many more. It must be noted that during all of this time, from the late 60s, Rex Deakin was in command as the Sunday School superintendent, taking over from Len Key, who was the first holder of this office. The best way to see how the life of the church went along is to view the newspaper and other cuttings accompanying this DVD. Just pause and view, then continue. I apologise for cuttings not taken as carefully as they should be, but their content is still of interest. The next event that had a major impact on church life was the 30th anniversary celebrations in 1996. This was during Reverend Judith Briner's time with us. It was decided to make a splash, particularly as the Wordsley Carnival, with its procession of floats, was the weekend before the church's birthday. At that time, Jeff Kite owned a haulage company, and one of his vehicles was a curtain-sided truck, which we could enter as a Wordsley Carnival float. The problem was what to put on it that would entertain and evangelise. At that time, Jeff Harrison, Rod Worthington and Peter Rodenite were able to play as an all-electric combo of keyboards, guitar and bass respectively. The rear half of the truck had a black on white outline of the church, being easily recognisable due to its unusual design. This half was manned by gentlemen and ladies attired in clothes of John Wesley's era. The message was me and the other occupants of Jeff's wagon singing gospel, once Brian got the pesky generator working. We put on a good performance for the float judges, but we didn't win, not that that was our priority. I remember on our way back from Wordsley Park, we stopped outside Marion Norris's home and serenaded her as she was troubled with illness, which sadly caused her to pass away sometime later. She is sadly missed as an accomplished musician and Sunday school staff member. We thought we must involve all the folk and groups who are associated with the church over the years, and these good people presented appropriate party pieces from comedy to theatre to singing. That filled the first half of the Saturday celebration show, but what about the second half? We ummed and ahed for a while, then a crazy idea came to me. Let's bring new streamers together again after 22 years. That will never happen, but it did. I dug into the old diaries and what records existed, and we contacted as many past members as we could. Of course, many, like Sheila and those folks still attending the church, were easy to find, but a little more effort was required to find those with changed names or who had left the area. But succeed we did, and the result is on YouTube as Celebration Parts 1 and 2. Tags, new streamers, David Atkinson, Celebration. I wrote out the tune lines with chords of the songs we sang for the musicians and word sheets for group and audience, and amazingly the whole production came together brilliantly, with only half the afternoon to rehearse before it was time to partake of the birthday tea. Meanwhile, back in the Sunday school, Suzanne Truman joined the teaching staff and was gratefully received, helping to spread the load of lesson preparation and so on. She, like me, is not so sprightly now as we share the aggravation of arthritis. Back to the funny shows. Arrivals at the ball, please welcome Mr. and Mrs. Itis and their son Arthur. While all this was happening, I enjoyed playing the piano for and helping Bella Greystone with the orchestra. Rex, who sort of instigated this epic tale, had been the general superintendent of the Sunday school, and he was in need of a break after many years, and Mark from our department took over. This concerned me a little as I had gone from accompanist to full teaching mode and felt a little unsure about what was happening, but do not despair. Emma White joined me as my teaching accomplice and we were quite successful in the teaching partnership. The time came for me to retire from my day teaching job as my body was deciding big time to get back at me with Parkinson's disease and arthritis and of more recent times, mild prostate cancer and top-notch renal carcinoma. However, the outlook for those is quite optimistic as CT scans show no more malignant areas. The time came to step aside in Sunday school too. I hope the gaffer is happy with an association with the Sunday school of somewhere around 50 years. During the whole of this time, our own children were working their way through Sunday school too. Of course, like all who follow Jesus, they have to make their own way and their own decisions. All we can do is point them in the right direction, wind them up, set them off powered by prayers and see how they go.